Call your first witness.
The state will call Mr. Clint Bearden, please, Your Honor. Raise your hand on him, sir. Swear for the testimony you're about to give him about the state of Georgia versus Nydia Tisdale, the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I do.
You have a seat. Could you introduce yourself to the jury, please, sir?
My name is Clint Bearden.
How are you employed, Mr. Bearden?
I'm sorry.
How are you employed?
I am a private practicing attorney in Blue Ridge, Georgia, and also serve as an associate judge of the Magistrate Court of Dawson County.
I want to direct your attention to August 23rd, 2014. Do you recall that day?
I do.
What was going on that day, Mr. Bearden?
There was a rally for Governor Deal at her smoking farm.
All right. Now, were you involved in that rally in any way?
I was.
How were you involved?
I helped organize that event a couple of weeks before the event, before August 23rd. I had been asked, was contacted to help organize an event for Governor Deal. He was going to be passing through Dawson County. So I had reached out to Mr. Burt, and we had several events at his farm before. So I had asked him if he was agreeable to letting Mr. Governor Deal come and, you know, kind of meet and greet with folks, basically.
Okay, so a greet to meet with Governor Deal. Now, did you, were you a member or organizer with the Republican Party at that time?
I had served previously as the chairman of the Dawson County Republican Party, but at that time I wasn't the chairman, I really wasn't involved with the party that had been involved in politics, but was really no longer involved at that point in time.
All right. Now, did you coordinate with anyone else other than Burt's in organizing this greet to meet for Governor Deal?
The campaign staff with the governor, they had contacted and, you know, and asked if I could set up the event, so then I reached out to Mr. Burt, and really that was kind of it, essentially. I mean, we had the event start, planned the event, and then the event kind of grew beyond that to some extent.
We'll talk about that in a minute. Now, did you encounter this defendant that day on that farm?
Yes, Ms. Tisdale.
Right. Did you know her before you encountered her that day?
I did not.
Now, was this meet and greet or rally, was it advertised?
I believe it was. By someone, it was advertised, yes.
Did you see any advertisements?
I did see advertisements.
Okay, now, did you authorize any of the advertisements?
Not that I recall. I saw a Facebook post. I think that was the staff. There is an ad that has my name and phone number, but I never saw that ad before that ad being taken out.
What did you do at the rally?
That day, I showed up probably about 20, 30 minutes before the rally. When I got there, about a week before the event, I had learned that Senate candidate David Perdue was also going to possibly attend, and that Senator Perdue, or now Senator Perdue, at that time, Candidate Perdue, if his schedule could accommodate, he would attend. I showed up that day. Essentially, it kind of morphed into the entire Republican ticket. All the folks that were running as Republican office holders for the state of Georgia were there. So when I showed up, they had staffers from the Georgia Republican Party were there. They had brought microphones, microphones, speakers, those things, obviously lots of signs and all of the kind of traditional fanfare of campaigns. They had a run of show that they had a schedule of who they wanted to speak and how that schedule was going to, going to go. And basically that day, I was just there as a guest. Mr. Burt, traditionally at these events, we had a few kind of fundraisers and other events of similar nature at the farm before, and Mr. Burt had asked me in the past to kind of introduce folks, to welcome folks. You know, a lot of times we'd have a Pledge of Allegiance, maybe someone to sing the Star Spangled Banner, someone to say a prayer. All of those things, and generally I had done in the past. Mr. Burt asked me if I would do that today as well, that day as well.
Now, when you coordinated this with Mr. Burt, who did you tell him was coming to do the speaking and to do the meet and greet?
We talked about it was just Governor Deal at that point in time.
Who owns Bird's Farm? Do you know Mr. Bearden?
Johnny and Daphne Bird.
Mr. Harvey, you need to stand up, please, so we can hear you.
I apologize, sir. I object to that. I don't know what the basis, no foundation for that.
I'll lay foundation. How long have you known the Bird family?
I'm 34 years old. I've known the Bird family for 28, 29 years of my life, since I was a little kid.
And have you ever been employed or paid money by the Bird?
I was. I worked from Bird, at Bird's Farm from eighth grade through my freshman year of college.
Have you ever represented in a legal capacity? You said that you were an attorney.
I have served as the attorney for the Birds.
Based on both of your, I guess, pre-law experience as a farmhand and then as a lawyer, do you know who owns Bird's Farm?
I do know who owns Bird's Farm.
Who owns it?
Johnny and Daphne Bird.
Again, I don't think that's the appropriate. I don't think the foundation has been laid. I object to that. I move to strike. There's a difference between who.
You've already made your objection. Would you like to discuss it further?
Yes.
Come up. The court has sustained the objection regarding ownership of, I believe it was termed, the Bert's Farm. Therefore, that testimony is stricken and you will not consider it. Yes, you may.
You sought permission from Johnny Bird. Why did you choose Johnny Bird?
Johnny Bird is the individual who is on the property, he owns the farm. He's also, if the farm, if I recall.
I have another objection. I think you just restated what you just sustained. Do you not?
No, I asked you a different question.
I know, but the answer.
Mr. Harvey?
I'm sorry. The answer restated what you. The objection that I just made. So I object to that testimony.
And therefore, the objection is sustained. You may rephrase and ask another question regarding that.
Yes, ma'am, I'll try. Why did you go to Johnny Bird to set up the rally?
The property of Bird's Farm LLC, has ownership of the property at Bird's Farm, or the Bird's are the CEO, CFO. They're the managing entities and the only members that I'm aware of Bird's Farm. So that event was sought to be held at Bird's Farm. That's why I requested Mr. Bird, because he would have the authority to grant permission to have the event at Bird's Farm.
Thank you. All right, now, did you do any coordination with the Lumpkin County Republican Party on this event, Mr. Bearden?
I did not.
White County?
I did not.
Did you do any coordination with Senator Perdue's office?
I did not.
Gary Black's office?
I did not.
Mark Butler?
Did not.
Richard Wood?
No, sir.
Sam Owens?
Yes, sir.
What about Ralph Hudgens? Any coordination with Mr. Hudson's office?
No, sir.
Let's talk a little about the rally itself. Were there going to be, was there going to be food?
Pumpkin pie, pumpkin rolls.
Okay, now.
Popcorn maybe?
In organizing the rally, did you sign a contract with the Burks for use of their property?
Yes, sir.
Did you provide them any payment for use of their property?
Yes, sir.
I want to show you. Do you recall how the seating was laid out?
I do.
Would you be able to draw if I brought an easel up there?
Absolutely could.
Judge, may I do so?
May.
The seating, just the way it's laid out. To do this, Mr. Bearden, in a way that our jurors can see it. Of course, Ms. Tisdale also has a right to see this. This is Mr. Hardy, but.
Judge, with your permission, can we move where we can see it a little bit better?
Go over there in that corner.
In that corner. And if Ms. Tisdale needs to go.
Stage of setup, the layout. I'm sorry, wait a moment. Where the speakers were, where folks were seated, and the folks that you specifically called where they were seated, okay?
Okay. Can I draw first and then explain?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Please.
Explain in a loud voice, Mr. Bearden.
Yes, Your Honor. Okay, this is essentially how the outdoor shed where the event was held was set up, that this is facing forward. The X is the speaker, the individuals who were the elected officials that were speaking. They're kind of front, center. These were the rows of seating, so there was a number of equal seats on each side with an aisle in the middle. And then recall that Ms. Tisdale was seated here. Governor and Mrs. Deal were seated in the front row on the opposite side. Ms. Tisdale was seated here. Johnny and Kathy Burke were seated approximately middle of this side, the side the governor's on. David Perdue and his wife were seated behind Johnny and Kathy Burke. And initially, I was standing over here on this side with several other individuals.
Do you recall seeing Captain Wooten there?
I do. So initially, let's see. Over here, there is Dan Bashan and Gerald Swafford were kind of seated at the edge of the shed. Initially, Tony Wooten, Officer Wooten, was there that day. And when the event began, Officer Wooten, as I recall, was kind of on this side. There's a little walkway that goes back into the main barn over here. And Officer Reed was standing in this vicinity and kind of on this side of the speaking event.
Could you, I hate to do it to you, could you label what these people are, please?
I can. My handwriting's not good. again, myself, Clint Bearden, Ms. Tisdale in the front row, Governor and Mrs. Deal on the opposite side, front row, Mr. and Mrs. Bird, being Johnny and Kathy Bird, in the middle, back at that same side, Mr. and Mrs. David Perdue. I, and this is the speaker. I seem to recall that Attorney General Owens was seated kind of in this general vicinity as well, on this side, I'm not sure which row. I believe Ms. Umberger may have been seated next to him.
Who is Ms. Umberger?
Linda Clary Umberger. And then Mr. Pritchard, Brian Pritchard was there, that I'm aware, knowing that I recognized him, and he's seated second or third row, I think third row, first seat, directly behind. These seats are pretty close, they're small chairs, so he's seated this row or this row. I recall that I think it's the third, it could have been the second, one of those two.
Let's see, they mark that. We just identified two additional people, Linda Clary Umberger. Who is she?
Linda, at that time, right. Yes.
Who is Linda Clary Umberger?
Ms. Umberger was at that time the Republican Party chairwoman for Dawson County.
And Mr. Brian Pritchard, who is he?
Mr. Pritchard is a gentleman that runs a news blog. I'll bet your news, and Mr. Pritchard was. He's from the Blue Ridge, Gilmore County area. I was familiar with him.
Okay. Now, at some point, did you see the defendant filming? Show where she was located.
I did. I mean, I'm standing in front, and didn't stand out to me that she was filming necessarily. I'm sure that I saw her filming, but at a point in time that Mr. Hutchins called the attention to her camera.
All right, so after you noticed her filming, is there a discussion about her filming?
There was a discussion.
Who all was present for that discussion?
I was there, Matt Burgess was standing beside me. Mac, there were several other staffers for other campaigns that were standing on that side of the shed. We were standing up, not seated. So there was a discussion among several of those folks trying to identify who Ms. Tisdale was, and no one really understood who she was or knew who she was.
Why were you trying to identify who she was?
At a point in time, one of the candidates called attention to her camera.
Objected and he moved to strike. It's hearsay.
I didn't understand.
Overruled.
There's attention called to our camera. There had been an incident before the event started.
Let me object to that. It's hearsay.
I'm up here.
Thank you. in another incident that morning or that afternoon involving him?
Before the event, yes, sir.
Can you explain without any hearsay what you were involved in?
For the event, there was a video tracker that was present. I had a video camera set up, and the video tracker was asked to leave the event.
All right. What is the video tracker?
Video tracker is essentially in a campaign setting, it's become a trend, and it's typically an individual that works for an opposing campaign that basically carries a video camera around and follows these people everywhere they go or any events, designed to try to capture footage that could be taken out of context and used in a campaign commercial that would be negative against that person generally.
So back to the discussion you had with Mr. Burgess and the other DOA agents. Was there a decision made to speak with Ms. Tisdale?
There was. Mr. Burgess made a decision to speak to Ms. Tisdale.
Object to that?
I'll strike that answer.
All right. Members of the jury, that answer has been stricken. Therefore, you are not to consider it.
Was there a decision made who was going to speak to Ms. Tisdale first?
There was.
Who was going to speak to her first?
Mac Burgess.
Did he, in fact, go speak to her?
He did.
Now, where were you when Mr. Burgess went to speak to
her? The time that Mac went to speak to Ms. Tisdale, I had actually gone from the side behind the speaker to where Officer Wooten was located at, kind of on that diagram, going back into the barn. At that point in time, because I observed Mr. Hutchins being upset with Mr. Wooten, expressing some displeasure with that Officer Wooten.
All right, Mr. Hutchins was at this point
in the vehicle. I'm sorry, Judge, but if there were some expressions out of court, it's hearsay.
I said expressing displeasure. Matt, can I follow up and make some foundation for that?
It's still hearsay.
Overruled.
How was Mr. Hutchins acting? Did you see, not what he said, but can you describe his demeanor, his manner?
Very, very animated. He appeared upset, angry.
So, now how many people are out present in this gallery area here when this is going on?
There's probably 70 to 80 people that day. I think that seemed to be about what the crowd size was.
After Mr. Burgess went over to where the defendant was, did you see her stop filming or appear to stop filming?
No.
All right. And did you see where Mr. Burgess went next?
So I came back. I had a conversation with Mr. Wooten, Mr. Hutchins, and his wife. At that point in time, I walked back over to the side of the barn where I had been standing prior to at the start of the event. At that point, Officer Wooten had followed behind me. And we're standing on the side. Mr. Burgess Mack is sitting in the front row next to Ms. Tisdale. And we exchanged looks. I went and sat down next to Mack and had a conversation with Mack at that point.
All right. I don't want to go into that. But after that conversation with Mr. Burgess, where did you go? What did you do?
As a result of that conversation with Mr. Burgess, I had then gone to Mr. and Ms. Bird, who were seated in the middle of the audience on the other side. I had Officer Wooten go with me. We went, knelt down, kind of kneeling in the aisle. These are, it's gravel area, gravel and dirt area. Kind of kneeling next to their chair and have a conversation with Johnny Kattenberg about the request from Ms. Tisdale to stop filming the event at that point in time.
During that conversation, you asked to determine whether or not the Burts knew who she was.
The Burts did not.
That would be hearsay. What do you mean it wouldn't be hearsay? Were you at
Mr. Harvey?
I'm sorry.
Are you talking to me?
No, Judge, I wasn't, and I apologize. But it is hearsay. It would be in a court statement offered for the truth of the matter, certainly I object to it.
Didn't I ask if you knew what he even said. I was, didn't be able to figure out if Burks knew who she was.
And then it would be speculation.
Mr. Harvey, I get to hear from you, and then I get to hear from Mr. Greer, and then I'm going to decide.
I know you are.
Sustained.
Yes, ma'am. After speaking with the Burks, did you have any clear picture about who she was?
There was an understanding.
Let's go with an understanding. Did you know who she was?
We did not know who she was.
That answers your question. All right.
You have an electronic device in this courtroom, and you have not been given permission to use it. Turn it off. Sorry. Yes. Yes, sorry.
Okay. Now, without going into the content of the conversation, did you have a detailed conversation with Burks?
Did have a detailed conversation with the Burks.
Did y'all exchange information at that time?
We did exchange information at that time.
Captain Wooten present during all this exchange of information?
Captain Wooten was present.
Thank you. Now, after the conversation with the Burks, what were your next actions, Mr. Burks?
After I spoke to John and Captain Bird, I went to the next road, Mr. Purdue and his wife. So, Ms. David Purdue was running for the United States Senate. I went and sat down next to David Purdue and his wife and had a conversation with David Purdue.
Right, so after the conversation with Mr. Purdue and his wife, what did you do then?
At that point in time, after I had left Mr. and Ms. Burr, Mr. Officer Wooten was there temporarily. He had apparently gone back to the side, standing on the side where I initially diagrammed that I was standing. I left Mr. and Ms. Purdue, I went back to the side, spoke to Officer Wooten, and told him that I would speak to Ms. Tisdale first, so as to hopefully not embarrass her, and I would make a request for her to stop filming before he had to do so.
All right, let's talk about that. Did you do that?
I did do that.
Can you describe that to the jury, please?
I did. I went behind Ms. Tisdale, kind of seated. She's facing forward. She's in the front row. I'm seated directly behind her, kind of adjacent over her left shoulder. So she's filming with her right hand, and she has her right hand on the video camera. I sit and I was kind of behind to the side of her, and I spoke to her at that point in time. I was trying to speak to her to ask her to stop filming.
How loud was your voice? Do you remember?
Loud enough that she obviously heard me because she had a conversation with me as well.
Okay, so there was a conversation. Did you tell her your name?
I really don't recall if I told her my name or not, to be honest.
Did you identify yourself as a representative of the Burks?
I am positive that I would have said I'm a representative. I'm doing this on behalf of the Burks.
I object to that. Sorry. Would have. That's not, that's speculation about what his former conduct might have been.
Overruled.
All right. May I continue?
Yes.
Thank you. After identifying yourself, did you ask her to stop? Well, what did you tell her?
I informed Ms. Tisdale that I had spoken with the Burks, and I asked if she stopped filming the event. And I made that request probably 3 to 4 times in total to ask her to stop filming the event, that they were requesting that she no longer continue to film. At one point, I believe I asked if she would stop and we were going to have a conversation or have a discussion about it. And it ultimately ended by Ms. Tisdale kind of saying, shh, you're interfering with my video. Please be quiet. You're interfering with my video. That was the end of it.
After she told you that, did she ever turn and look at you when she said that?
I don't recall that she did.
After being told that, did you go speak with the Burks? What did you do?
I'd literally just sit back in my chair, kind of cross my arms. I thought at the time that it was
object to what he thought at the time. It's an unexpressed mental operation that I object to.
I can rephrase.
Judge.
You're not the lawyer in this case. Let the attorney talk to the court.
Apologies.
It's also a present sense, impression or expression. I think it's allowable.
Over.
was a little rude, and I was kind of taken aback, essentially, so I just sit back and really didn't know what to do at that point.
Now, did she really say anything to you besides shh?
She did. She did mention that when I informed her that I had spoken with the Burks, and I sort of stopped, she said, "I have permission of Mrs. Kathy Burton." I said, "No, ma'am, I just spoke to Mrs. Burke. You do not have permission. She's asked you to stop. Has requested me to stop." So other than she informed me that she had permission of Mrs. Kathy Burton, and then she informed me to please stop, you know, please be quiet, you're interfering with my video.
Did you explain to her in detail that she did not have permission?
I did explain 3 to 4 times that she was being requested to not film at the request of the Burks.
Now, prior to, well, you're now sitting down. Where are you in relation to the defendant again?
I'm sitting essentially right behind her, kind of over her left shoulder.
At some point, did you observe Tony Wooten?
I did.
Make contact with the defendant?
I did. After all, I stood back, I kind of stood back in my chair. There's still a speaker speaking at that point in time. I think it was Commissioner Butler, Mark Butler. He was running for Labor Commissioner. I was speaking, and at that point, Officer Wooten came from the side where he had apparently been standing to kind of the side front of Ms. Tisdale.
Right. Was he in uniform?
He was in like a black sheriff's office polo shirt that has like the logo, the badge like logo, and khaki pants.
Now, were you present for the entire time that he was there with Ms. Tisdale?
I was there, yes, sir.
What did you see?
I saw Officer Wooten speak to Ms. Tisdale. There was a conversation that he was having with her or some request. And then ultimately, it led to the point where there was like physical confrontation, essentially.
Were you able to hear clearly anything that was being said between the two parties?
I couldn't hear what was being said, no, sir.
Talk about it, okay?
the video online, is it one continuous file, is it one, or what did it appear like?
I've seen different versions of the video. There's one version that's an extended video that kind of goes from beginning to end of the event itself. I've seen videos that Ms. Tisdale's posted of prior to the speaking event that started, that she's posted videos of conversations beforehand, or just her video and before the event kicked off. And then there's video, obviously, at the point that she is detained. There's video that's ongoing during that period. She's still filming, essentially, as the officer has her in custody.
All right. I am going to show you, I don't believe you've ever seen this.
No, sir, I don't recall seeing that video.
Okay, the party stipulated. That
What are you marking that?
This is going to be stated to one. These are all six different video clips retrieved from Mr. Dale's camera. And I intend that in evidence of stated to one.
Then you will need to substitute that for one, because I've already admitted one, which was not.
Played.
It was different. So let's make the record clear, please.
And how about States Exhibit 2?
That would be better. States Exhibit 2. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Mr. Harvey, any objection?
Thank you.
Entered without objection.
May I puzzle you there?
Yes.
He is not. So who are you with, press? Yeah, sorry, we just had a lot of.
Today, we really appreciate having you here at Bird's Farm. I think we're ready to get this show on the road today, get everyone that you came to see, let them start talking and kind of giving you an update about the strong Republican ticket that we have this year. Just very quickly want to give extra special thanks, as always, to Johnny and Kathy Bearden, the entire Bird family, for allowing us to have this event here at Bird's Farm. For all the hospitality that they've extended. So thank you very much to Johnny and Kathy and the entire Bird family. It's really an honor. You know, this is something that many of you that are here were here 5 years ago in August of 2009 when Congressman Deal was running for governor. So it's really great to be here 5 years later and obviously helping to work reelect him to a much deserved second term. So we're glad to have everyone here today. One quick note of announcement. They do have pumpkin pie, pumpkin rolls, and lots of drinks, so help yourself to that. There are restrooms at the end of this building if you need to use the restroom. And then as you came in, y'all may have seen that gigantic pumpkin that was out there. That's the door prize for today. So after the governor speaks, before everyone leaves, we'll announce who's the door prize winner. Somebody's going to get to take home a giant pumpkin, because it wouldn't be a pumpkin farm without a giant pumpkin. So. With that, I'm going to turn it over to our insurance commissioner, Mr. Ralph Hutchins. We're really glad to have Commissioner Hutchins with us today. He's done a great job on the ballot this fall, and we'll let Commissioner Hutchins go from there. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for helping us reelect the complete Republican ticket. I tell you, for the first time ever, we've got a Republican in every office, and we need to keep it that way. In the insurance world, my battle right now, really not my battle, but what I get accused of having a battle is Obamacare. But let me tell you, Obamacare is a total, total disaster. If you want to get a quick glimpse of what Obamacare is going to result in if we don't repeal it, look at what's happening in the Veterans Administration. That's exactly what's going to happen with us if we don't repeal this. Now, I'm not saying let's just repeal it and do away with it. We need to repeal it and replace it. And there are some, Congressman Price, Tom Price from Georgia, has a wonderful plan, but we need to take an incremental approach to the problem we have with health care. We don't need an omnibus bill that does everything in the world like this one tried to do. You know, the president has delayed in this bill 71 different times. He has said, well, this is what the bill says, and then he changes his mind and he delays it. Governor, that doesn't happen in our state. I was in the legislature for 14 years. Every time we passed a bill, then we sent it to the governor. If the governor signed it, then it became law, and we expected the agency that it applied to uniformly enforce that bill and do what it says. But President Obama says that, well, I can just, I don't like this part, so we're going to delay it, and I think it's time we call his hands. I hope that I see our nominee for Senator David Perdue back here. We've got to elect David to help us get the majority in the U.S. Senate. If we can get the majority in the Senate and maintain the majority in the House, which we will, Congressman Collins is here.
All right.
Wherever he is, there he is. He's doing a great job, but we can maintain that majority, get the majority of the Senate, then we can call his bluff. Right now, Harry Reid is being an absolute obstructionist on everything that is a good piece of legislation, and we need to do our part. The only part we can do is to make sure that David Perdue is elected and Michelle Nunn is not. And I'm not going to get into that race, but I was at the I guess I am. I was at the Chamber of Commerce event where David and Michelle had a debate, and I have never seen anybody misrepresent their stands as much as Michelle Nunn did. All she wanted to do is talk about, we need to have a team, we need to have consensus building, we need this and that, and I thought I was going to have to resuscitate my wife. I thought she was going to pass out, and I thought I was going to absolutely puke listening to her. I mean, I don't know why you're videotaping, but yes, I said that. Anyway, I'm running for re-election. I have two opponents. I have a lady that she ran for insurance commissioner in Florida. She lost that. Then she moved to Georgia. She ran for state rep against John Burns. She lost that. Then she ran for chairman of the county commission in Bullock County. She lost that. Then she ran for clerk of court in Bullock County, and she lost that. And I was telling a campaign consultant about her record, and his response is, boy, she's due. And I said, no, Michael, that's not what I'm looking for. I want to keep her string alive. But the funny one was, I was on the 14th floor of the West Tower, and a guy was up there, and he said, aren't you Ralph Hudgens? And I said, I am. He said, well, and I can't remember his name for the life of me, but he introduced himself. He said, I'm running against you for insurance commissioner. I said, you are? So what brought that on? He said, well, I used to be a Republican. I got real disenfranchised with what they were doing. And so I started going to the Libertarian Party meetings. I was at the Libertarian Party meeting in Cobb County. They were going over their candidate list, and they said, we need somebody to run for insurance commissioner. He said, well, I've got 22 years experience as an agent. They said, good, you're our candidate. That's the way he's in there. But I need to get over 50% of the vote. With your help, that'll happen. And with your help, we'll be able to keep our Republican ticket. And I want to introduce a friend of mine, Richard Woods. Richard is who I supported in the primary because he was opposed to Common Core, and I'm opposed to Common Core, and so I supported him. But Richard Woods is our the candidate for school superintendent, And let's give him a warm Dawson County welcome.
That's Mr. Burgess.
Well, again, one of the good things here that if I guess Mr. Huck.
Did it just appear on the screen?
The tab and the white, oh, no, sure, that's Mr. Burgess immediately.
He's here that if I guess Mr. Hudgens does lose his cookies, I work at an elementary school, so I have experience that I can come in behind and make sure everything's taken care of. But my name is Richard Woods, and again, I can honestly say I am not in South Georgia. This is a beautiful part of the state, but I do live in Tipton, Georgia. So I'm about four and a half miles south of here. But it is a privilege to be the Republican nominee for state superintendent of schools. And as your next state school superintendent, again, one of the things I can assure you is that I do bring experience to this office. Again, for 22 years, I worked in the Urban County school system, working 14 years as a classroom social studies teacher and 8 years in administration, working from assistant principal, principal K-5 curriculum director, and the list goes on and on with that. But again, everything was pre-K through 12th grade at the school level. So, things that I talk about come from firsthand experience. And because of that, I have that firsthand experience, one of the things we look at is that what are we going to do for our children, and what are we going to do for our school system to make sure that each child has the opportunity to succeed. Well, first thing, we are going to be child-focused, and that means we are going to make sure that we personalize and not standardize education, because our children, it is not one size fits all. They are completely different, and we need to have the flexibility to take our children where they are at and move them forward. And that is my commitment to do that, because if we fail the children, honestly, we have failed in education. So that will be the primary focus to do that. But in order to make sure that we are personalize our education system, that means we got to go to our teachers. And we've got to allow our teachers to once again do the job that they went to school to do. And we do that by reducing and eliminating unnecessary paperwork, data collecting. And instead of teaching to the test, we teach to the child. Again, coming from a period with no child left behind, which I worked very diligently with, all we heard about was the test.
Is that you, Mr. Bearden, that just walked behind him?
That was me and an officer we went behind me.
Test. Well, at that point, we began to miss the important thing in education, where it should be about the child. And in doing that, by focusing on our teachers and our kids, that means we concentrate on our classroom. By concentrating on the classroom, we will make sure that our kids, by the time they leave fifth grade, they will be proficient in reading, writing, and math, because those are the foundational skills that build on any and everything else that goes on beyond that point. For myself as a high school social studies teacher, content was not an issue. But the issue that I had was that our kids needed to read and reading comprehension. And as your next state school superintendent, my commitment is to make Georgia the number one literate state in our nation. Because if we can teach our kids to read, if they can have that foundation, the doors of opportunity will be boundless to them. And so we will do that. But also being a foundationist, that means that we'll do some things that we look at and we make sure that our kids understand and appreciate our great, rich history. We will teach history and be more diligent with that. We will teach the Constitution, the Declaration of Independence, the Federalist Papers, all the great works that we have. We will not leave that out, because I firmly believe that as our children leave the high school and Georgia education, if they understand it's better to be independent from and not dependent on government, we have done a great thing. Because that means we will have citizens that will begin to build on our capitalistic, system we have as far as economics, but also they will remember and cherish, what has made America great. And that is something that we have to do that is very, very important. Again, I also need your help. And again, please go to my website, woodsforsuper.com, and visit there and join us on Facebook and Twitter, because, I still do math the old-fashioned way. And what I understand is that I'm just one individual. But you out here, you know 10 people who know 10 people who know 10 people. And so we have to get that message out that we have the best plan and we have the best organization for us. And now I would like to introduce our current and our next Commissioner of Labor, or Secretary of Labor, Mark Butler. So again, appreciate that.
I don't think they gave me enough link here to work with. I like to move around. Y'all excited about this election?
Yeah.
All right, we need you to be. This is a very important election. Got a lot to talk about. First of all, we've got to give everybody a kind of example about the difference between a Democrat-run departmental labor and a Republican run the Department of Labor. When I got there, we had a very, very bloated Department of Labor. We had what I thought was way too many employees. So we said, you know what? The people elected me to give you efficient government. And we've done that. We've reduced our workforce, not positions, that's the difference. Some people are tricky with that. I'm talking about people there. We've reduced our positions by 31%. We have 650 less people working at the Department of Labor today than we had 3.5 years ago. And the good thing about that is, it seems like that'd be bad, but guess what? We're actually doing a better job today than we were doing 3.5 years ago, because we're concentrating on getting people a job, not an unemployment check, because that's what it's really about. Now, there's been a lot of talk here recently about, you know, oh, Georgia is going the wrong direction. Well, let's talk about that really quick. Now, I'm going to kind of give you the numbers, and the governor's going to tell you a little bit more about it in just a minute. But let's just talk about this latest little bump in the unemployment rate. You know, little Mr. Carter, he is very upset right now about the unemployment rate. He's very concerned about the job loss we've seen over the last 3 months. But guess what? He's not telling you the whole story. Anybody like to guess which private sector has lost jobs over the last 3 months? That's not private sector. You pretty much answered it. It has not been any private sector job loss. The job loss comes from 45,000 jobs lost.
What is your name? Sir, what is your name? What is your name, sir? Identify yourself. What is your name? What is your name? Let go of me. What is your name, sir? Let go of me. I spoke with the owner prior to the beginning.
No, Mrs. Burks, Kathy Burks said it was okay.
Let go of me, sir.
Final clip 00040. do, and I tried to work with him, and I talked to him.
I spoke with several candidates, and they didn't mind. I spoke with the owner. I spoke with Kathy Bird.
I spoke
with Kathy Bird. I'm the owner, and I said no. Mrs. Burt said it was okay. Kathy Bird said it was okay. I spoke to her when I first arrived. I spoke with Kathy Bird, and she said it was okay.
And then I kind of spoke with you and told your owners, did not want you to do that. You can record all you want, that's fine. And then you resisted. And then you resisted some more, and then you fought with me.
I didn't fight with you. You're the one who has grabbed me. This was a public event posted on Facebook by Governor Dew. This was a public event posted on Facebook by Governor Dew. Kathy?
You just talked to the owner who asked you to leave, who's told you you couldn't do this here, and you're still
leaving. Okay, I'll leave.
No, you're leaving. Now you're going to jail. You resisted me, my lawful duties, trying to get you to cooperate. You didn't want to do that. You fought with me. You wrestled with me. So we're just going to wait, and we're going to go to jail. I don't know what else to do with you. I tried to talk to you. I tried
to explain.
Please
listen to your grip. I'm not going anywhere.
You decided to act like you're somebody and stop fighting with me.
I'm sorry, sir. What did you say?
So as soon as you stop fighting with me,
I'm not resisting you.
You're not now because I'm not giving you a choice anymore, but you fought me the entire way over here and continued to fight with me. I don't know you. I don't know what you have on you. And I don't like it when I tell you to stop doing something and you continue to do it. I don't know what you have in that
I don't know you either. You have not given me your name, sir.
And I'll be happy to. You'll see it on the
board.
And
what is your name? Tell me your name, sir. And show me your badge.
You've seen my badge.
No, I haven't, actually.
Yes, you have.
I didn't.
Yes, you have.
You did not see me.
Yes, you have.
Please, sir. It's like
stop resisting. You keep saying you're being nice for your camera. Stop resisting.
Mrs. Burtz. I spoke with her in advance. I told her I was here. I had my camera.
The owner of the place.
Ow! That hurts. You're hurting me. You're hurting me.
Stop.
You are really hurting me.
Stop.
You are hurting me.
All you gotta do is be still.
You said that. Just that you see behind her. What did you witness when Captain Wooten began escorting her out?
Captain Wooten came up, he had an initial conversation with Ms. Tisdale. At a point, he then placed his hand in front of her camera. At that point in time, Ms. Tisdale swatted with her left hand, she swatted in the air. I thought she made contact with him, and then he grabbed her by the arm, and both arms, and essentially kind of She's standing. I don't know how they came to stand, if he pulled her up or if she's standing, but she's standing. He has her arms. They're going out. She has the video camera still in her hand. She's just kind of flailing her arms and legs, essentially, as he's trying to get her to go to the barn.
No. Did you see him strike her?
No.
In the barn. You see how he had her restrained?
When I was in the barn, for the periods of time, I didn't see how he had her restrained in that period.
Right. How did he ever restrain you?
He had her arm behind him. He had her left arm behind her back, kind of propped against the counter that you saw in the video. Essentially leaned over the counter.
Right. Did you see where he was standing in relation to her?
He was behind her, but not like immediately, not pressed upon her.
Now, when you were in the barn, who had control of that video camera?
Ms. Tisdale had control of the video camera.
Mm-hmm.
table in a gray suit with me.
This makes himself evident, but do you know what county Burt Holmes is located in?
It's in Dawson County, Georgia.
I have no further questions for Mr. Bearden at this time. Thank you.
Mr. Harvey?
Yes, ma'am.
I think it's still morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm good, thank you.
So, good morning. I understand, Mr. Bearden, Mr. here, that you are an attorney currently in private practice, correct?
That's correct, sir.
You're also a magistrate.
That's correct, sir.
And that's a part-time magistrate?
Yes, sir.
You have also, as I understand it, been currently at least on the short list for a Superior Court judge position?
That's correct, sir.
And what circuit is that?
Northeastern Judicial Circuit.
And does that cover Dawsonville?
It does, sir.
You've been here for a number of years.
My entire life.
And you've had a long in close relationship to the Burtons, correct?
That's correct.
And as I understood it, you were hired by them, I guess, in high school or early?
Eighth grade.
Eighth grade.
Yes, sir.
Right. And worked for them for a period of time, correct?
That's correct.
So that relationship has been a long relationship.
Yes, sir.
And I understand that in the past that you have represented, I guess, either the family or one or the other of them, correct?
Yes, sir.
Is that right?
Yes, buddy.
Sure. So, in that regard, you also previously had been the chairman of the Dawson County Republican Party, am I correct about that?
I did, yes, sir. I have been.
And going back to 2014, did the chairmanship of the Dawson County Republican Party change around 2014?
Changed in 2013, I believe, if I recall correctly.
Because last time we talked, you said it was either 2013 or 2014. So you had fairly recently been the chairman, correct?
Correct.
And that chairmanship went over to Linda Claire Umberger, who you told us was the current chairman, and we saw on the video, at the time that this incident occurred, correct?
Correct.
And indeed, she was at the function as well.
She was, yes, sir.
And we saw her at the end of that video.
Right.
Now, I guess that you have been in politics at least for a while, right?
Since college, yes, sir.
And you're familiar with, are you not, the way that political rallies or political events are either, well, let's start with organized. You're familiar with that, right?
Yes, sir.
Well, you're familiar with the way they're handled, correct?
If it's a planned event, yes, sir.
Okay. And you're familiar with the manner in which they're executed. I mean, you've done all these things for a while.
I've been involved in campaigns, so those things are kind of encompassed within that, yes, sir.
Well, sure. And you told us, I think, you told the ladies and gentlemen of the jury, Mr. Carrera, that you had done those events previously because you had interned with Governor Deal, correct?
I had, yes, sir.
And that not only had you interned with Governor Deal, you had interfaced or you had dealings with him when he was in his first run for governor, correct?
That's correct.
And you had organized these kinds of meet and greets previously, right?
He had a fundraiser for Governor Deal at Pumpkin Farm in his first run for governor.
Right. So this was not an unfamiliar experience for you?
Not really.
And there are different kinds of fundraisers or events, correct?
Yes.
Well, you know what I'm getting at, Mike. There are private events. There are private events when the candidates say, by invitation only, we're going to have the governor at my home, and I'm going to invite 10 people or 20 people, and that's a private event, correct?
Some handle that way, yes, sir.
Okay, that's some are handled that way. And they're private events, and generally, those are fundraising events, correct?
They oftentimes are, yes, sir.
Right, because when you're in private, you can say things and you can ask for, you know, donations of more than a small amount, right?
Correct.
Okay. And those are clearly private events, right?
Largely.
Right. There are not necessarily private events, but just by invitation only events, correct?
There are events like that, yes, sir.
Right. And finally, there are public events, right?
I think there's a range of public events.
Okay. There's a range of public events, but there are certainly public events in which they are advertised, for example, correct?
Correct.
And that it's posted on social media, correct?
Correct.
And that it's specifically, or they specifically acknowledge that anybody, any member of the public can come to the event, right?
There's something like that, yes, sir.
Right. And when these public events are held, they're held for a number of reasons. They're held to generate interest in the candidate, correct?
Generally, yes, sir.
They are held, hopefully, to get new people to come and hear what the candidates have to say, correct?
That'd be one reason, yes, sir.
They are held so that people can meet the voters of their community or others in the community in order to broaden their base, correct?
That would be a reason, yes, sir.
And so there are a number of reasons to have an open event as opposed to a private event, correct?
There could be, yes, sir.
Right. This particular event, of course, was an open to the public event, correct?
I know there are advertisements that were put out. I know the governors or someone had a Facebook posting, but the event wasn't initially planned as just a wide open public event per se. I called people to invite them to the event, but mostly friends, people in the community.
Well, you would ordinarily do that anyhow. You would do that. You would call your friends and say, hey, the governor's going to be up here. You want to go to this event and meet the governor.
Correct.
So that's not an unreasonable or uncommon type of occurrence either, correct?
Yeah.
But you've seen, have you not, the governor's announcement?
I've seen it after, yeah, yes, sir. I've seen it in the point of time since past.
Well, sure, but you know, you've kept up with this. Exhibits. I'm going to hand you what's been marked as evidence exhibit number one, please. Judge, these are non-denominational. I'm going to put D, Delta 1 for defendant 1.
I beg you.
And Mr. Bearden, you've seen that before, correct?
Yes, sir, I have seen this.
Does it accurately represent the announcement for the Dawsonville rally by Governor Neal and Senator Perdue?
It does announce a Dawsonville rally that appears to be the Governor Neal, the event that was held August 3rd, yes, sir.
Okay, for admission of defendants, exhibit 1.
No objection.
Entered without objection. It's got Nydia Tisdale profile, correct?
Correct, yes, sir.
All right. And it is an announcement by Ms. Tisdale, and she is coordinating, trying to get folks to this rally, having seen the public display of this invitation, as it were, correct?
I'm not certain, sir. It looks like that was that screenshot was taken 11 months after the event, it appears.
Okay, well, then we'll go to another one. But this one's in evidence, and it shows that 75 people that she advised went. 22 babies, but 515 people she invited, correct?
I don't know if that's how that works necessarily. I believe that that's like the event organizers' invitations.
But that was the advertisement, was it not, that was up?
I believe so, yes, sir. That's an accurate depiction, yes, sir.
Okay, good. Thank you. This particular rally was also advertised in various other media, correct?
Yes, sir. I'm aware of other advertisements.
Let me hand you what's been marked as Defendant's Exhibit Number 2 and Defendant's Exhibit Number 3. Objection to their
admission. No, sir.
Move to admit defendants 2 and 3.
Enters without objection.
I'm going to put them up on the screen again.
Yes, sir. Mr. Mayor.
Zoom out. You see that, okay?
I can see that, yes, sir.
Folks, can y'all see that, okay? Lumpkin County Republican Party would like to announce you are cordially invited to meet Governor Nathan Deal and David Perdue, correct?
Which exhibit is that, Mr. Hall?
This is defendant's exhibit number two, Jim, for the record, sorry.
That's correct, that's what I read, sir.
Yes, and it was at Burt's Pumpkin Farm, correct?
Correct.
And it was for August 23rd.
Correct.
At 3:30 to 4:30, correct?
Correct.
Now, this announcement, you can see at the bottom, says contact Clint Bearden at a phone number.
That's right.
Or your email address.
Correct. Right? Yes, sir.
Now, perhaps I'm mistaken, and I don't remember, but you didn't put that advertisement in a paper or a flyer or anything, right?
Hey, sir, let me clear you. I'm going to take the ad out. I guess that ad appeared in the Dahlonega Nugget, apparently, and this unmurder took the ad out and paid for the ad, is my understanding. I had not seen the ad until after the event and all of the other social media posts that popped up. I did not take the ad. I had not approved the ad.
Well, but it was taken out by the chairman of the Lumpkin County or Dawson County Republican Party.
I'm not certain. There was a chair of the Lumpkin County Party as well. I think that was Mr. Williams at that time. My understanding is that Ms. Unmurder coordinated that because she had called and said she was going to possibly take out an ad, if I recall, conversation I had with Ms. Unmurder.
I wasn't asking you about the conversation you may or may not have had, okay? But that's an advertisement that you've seen before. Did you get any calls, by the way?
I didn't, but that is my cell phone number. That's all I know. I wouldn't have taken the ad out.
Let me hand you what's been marked as Exhibit 4, when you said the Dahlonega Nugget. Is that a copy of the same ad that was taken out in the Dahlonega Nugget?
Is that four or three?
Four. Did I miss three? Oh, all right.
You mentioned a three, but I'm not sure, but not a four.
Right.
Tender?
I'm tendering four, but I still have to talk to him about three.
Okay. Any objections to four?
No objections.
All right. Any without objection?
But that's the same ad, but it shows that it was in the Dahlonega Nugget, right?
I think that's correct, yes, sir.
Okay. Same ad there at the bottom?
Yes, sir.
This is defendant's exhibit number four, and it shows that it's in the Dahlonega Nugget, August 20th of 2014, right?
Correct, sir.
Okay. Defendant's three is already in evidence. Please join us for a visit with Governor Nathan Deal and U.S. Senate candidate David Perdue, correct?
Correct, yes, sir.
Show us a picture of both candidates. Saturday at Burt's Pumpkin Farm, right?
Correct.
And down at the bottom, it says the event is free and all are welcomed and invited to attend, correct?
That's correct.
In the advertisements that you saw or know about, there was no restriction as to political parties, correct?
No, sir.
No restriction as to affiliation with any group.
No, sir.
Correct. No restriction with regard to audio recording or filming.
Correct. Yes, sir. That's correct.
No restriction to with regard to pictures being taken.
That's, you're correct. There's no restriction.
So Insofar as this rally is concerned, we are talking about something that was totally, at least towards the public, as far as the public knew, completely unrestricted. It wasn't a paid event, and it wasn't a private event per the advertisements, correct?
I'm not really certain if I can answer that and say, I mean, it does say it to the public, yes, sir.
Okay. I also understood that you, sometime before the event in question, had been contacted to set the event up.
Correct.
You were contacted by the Deal campaign, correct?
Correct.
And do you recall the date?
It was pretty close in time. I think approximately two weeks beforehand, maybe a few days before 2 weeks, but not very far out.
Could it have been sometime around August 19th or so?
No, the event was the 23rd, if I recall, so it would have been before August the 19th. They initially contacted me, at least.
Okay. Do you recall getting, you told us about Mr. Wood, do you recall getting any texts from him with regard to the upcoming event?
I do, yes, sir. A Facebook message, if I recall.
I'm sorry, I don't know whether it's Facebook or not. You what has been marked now as Defendant's Exhibit 5. And ask you if you recognize Defendant's Exhibit 5.
Thank you. So I know the first page of the conversation that I had with Officer Wooten. I do not recognize the second page. That is not my conversation.
Well, how about the first page?
The first page is, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir, I do. That week of the event, it would have been around the 18th or 19th initially, because the week of the event, I had called Sheriff Carlisle, who was the sheriff of Dawson County at that time, from my time when I was the Republican Party chairman. If we had someone like a governor or a senator or a congressman in Dawson County, I always notified the sheriff. Dawson County does not have a lot of deputies, so I did that for security reasons, to let them know that you know, someone of some stature would be in Dawson County. I called Sheriff Carlisle to give him a heads up that the governor was going to be at Burke's. I got the voicemail for the sheriff, tried back on, I think, Wednesday of that week.
I'm sorry, I didn't ask you about a voicemail.
I'm sorry.
From somebody else, which would be yours.
That leads to the conversation I had.
Still need to ask you about that. All right. So, it was some time before that you had some conversation with, well, at least texts or Facebook.
That's a Facebook message, yes, sir.
Facebook message with Mr. Wooten with regard to this event, correct?
I believe it was on the 19th of May, yes, sir.
Okay. There were, at least at the beginning, a number of speakers, as we saw in the advertisements, that it morphed into, like you told us. It went from Gill to Purdue to pretty much the entire Republican ticket, correct?
Right, yes, sir.
For statewide office.
For statewide office, yes, sir.
So it became a pretty big event, and if anybody wanted to see the entire Republican ticket and get a chance to see their statewide candidates, this would have been a good opportunity to do that, right?
I suppose it would have been, yes, sir.
Okay. Well, it's not often, from your experience, that you get a whole group of statewide office runners' tickets in one place at one time because they're off politics.
Generally, I think on that particular day, they had all been at multiple events, so apparently.
So it kind of coalesced into that.
Correct.
Is that right? All right. And we're still before the event.
Yes, sir.
I haven't even got that yet.
Okay.
But we will, I promise you. Before the event, had you ever seen Ms. Tisdale?
Physically, no, not personally.
Had you ever talked to Ms. Tisdale?
I had not.
Had you been provided any information about Ms. Tisdale?
I knew about the lawsuit in the city of Cumming, but didn't recognize who she was.
Okay. But, so the answer to that is no.
Yes, sir.
So you had no information about her. You didn't know who she was. And at least prior to the event, nobody came up to you and said, hey, we got to keep this lady out, right?
That's correct.
Okay. You had no information and nobody told you that she, Ms. Tisdale, was a tracker.
No one knew who she was at that point.
Right. So the answer is you had no information prior to the event or even prior to the time that she was removed, forcibly removed, that she was a tracker. Right?
Certainly a concern, but no information.
Right, no. So the answer is you had no information. Right? In fact, I would suspect that before the event, her being unknown to you and perhaps to anybody else, nobody said anything to you about her at all.
Right. Correct.
You yourself were not in any official capacity there with the Republican Party.
Correct, right, sir.
candidates, particularly Governor Deal, who you knew and had worked for, correct?
That's correct.
And the other candidates, and to help get a venue to the event, right?
Well, initially, get a venue for Governor Deal.
Right, but then it
morphs into more.
And the event sort of took over.
Right.
But that's okay. The more candidates, the more people, the better it is for the candidates. That's what candidates want, isn't it?
I guess it's what candidates want.
Okay. You are not an authorized representative of the Republican Party, correct?
I didn't have an official role in the Republican Party, no, sir.
Right. So you are not an authorized representative of the Republican Party, correct?
Right, yes, sir.
By the way, are you aware of any policy that the Republican Party has that prohibits filming?
I have no knowledge of that.
Okay, and you had no knowledge of that when you were the chairman?
No, sir.
Well, no, you didn't have any. There was no policy that you knew of.
If there is a policy, I was not aware.
Okay. Now, prior to the time that the event actually kicked off, there was an opportunity for people to sort of get their feet wet, introduce themselves, wander around the Burns Farm location, which is a very beautiful location, right?
Correct.
The candidates would arrive. The meet and greet part was, we saw the barn, correct?
Correct.
And it would go, the meet and greet part, you'd go into that barn and say hello to everybody, correct?
Yes, sir.
But we could clearly see on the video that we saw candidate Purdue arriving, correct?
Correct.
We saw Ms. Tisdale filming candidate Purdue coming out of his bus, correct?
Yes, sir.
And going into the right?
Yes, sir.
Nobody told her, boy, there's no filming here, lady. Go on about your business, right?
I'm not sure what anyone else said.
Well, you didn't see it, you didn't hear it, right?
I did not see or hear that, no, sir.
Okay, and by the way, did you see or hear any signs posted at Burt's Farm that said, all are welcome, but no photographs. All are welcome, but no video. All are welcome, but no recordings of any kind.
Yes, sir, I didn't observe that.
Because there weren't any, right?
Not that I'm aware.
And if you wanted to do that, you surely could have put up a sign, right?
I don't know.
Well, you don't know, Mr. Chairman?
I mean, I guess someone could. I mean,
anybody could. And you can put it on the advertisements. You could put it on the social media. You could put it on the barn. You could put it anywhere. If you didn't want people to record the event, right?
I suppose Mr. Bearden didn't control those things at that point.
Well, he could have, couldn't he?
I don't know that I'm qualified to speak to that.
Okay, all right. You saw candidate Purdue go in, right?
I didn't personally watch it.
On the video?
On the video, yes, sir. On the video, absolutely.
It's in it. You saw him stop and talk to Mr. and Mrs. Bird, correct?
Yes, sir.
And you saw Ms. Tisdale videoing the people that were there coming and going and the entrance into the, was that the place where the speechifier was going to be?
No, sir, the speeches were outside under a different shed, like an outside open covered pavilion.
So people would actually have to move from that location to another location, correct?
That's correct.
Right. And then we see that, then you are kind of, I gets designated to be the MC. I'm going to call him.
Right. Mr. Byrd asked me to introduce, just kind of say hello, welcome everyone, tell them where the restrooms were, where the pumpkin pie, popcorn, all of that stuff was at.
And we saw you do that.
Right.
And you talked about the pumpkin pie.
Yes, sir.
And you thanked Mr. and Mrs. Byrd.
Yes, sir.
But you didn't say who you were. Did you hear you say, "Hi, I'm Clint Bearden"?
I don't think so. I don't recall. I didn't hear it.
Okay.
I don't recall if I did.
The video would show it, but you didn't identify yourself, correct?
No, at that time, no.
Okay.
Sir.
All right. And then the speeches started. Now, Ms. Tisdale had a handheld video camera, correct?
That's correct, sir.
And she had a handheld video camera in which she was clearly visible with that handheld video camera, correct?
She's in the front row with the handheld video camera.
And that, I was going to get there in a second. By the way, she, you have seen and you know that she had pictures snapped of her with the sitting attorney general before she went in, right?
I've seen those after the fact, yes, sir.
Well, you recognize him, right?
I recognize who she is and who Ms. Rollins is, yes,
okay.
Sir.
And you knew that they were taken there at the Burt's Pumpkin Farm?
The AJC informed me of that in the article I read, yes, sir.
All right. I don't think there's going to be an objection to this, but I'm going to move defendant's exhibit number
10, number 6.
Okay. I move defendant's exhibit number 6, Judge. No objection.
Any objection?
No objection, Judge.
Not objection.
Let me show you defendant's exhibit number 6. Defendant's exhibit number 6, who's that on the left?
That is Mr. Sam Owens, who was formerly the Attorney General, is now famous all states president.
Right. And he was the Attorney General at the time that this event occurred.
That's correct.
I mean, he was the Attorney General of the state of Georgia, the highest law enforcement officer in the state, right?
He's the Attorney General, yes, sir.
Right. Okay. And who is that on the right?
That's Ms. Tisdale.
All right. That's the person that you just identified here in court and you're right to examination, right?
Yes, sir.
When you, after you made that introduction, you were standing in front of the seats, correct?
To the side, essentially, of the front row of the seats.
Miss Tisdale was in the front row, was she not?
She was.
She wasn't concealing her camera in any way?
No, sir.
In fact, when she filmed, she had her camera up, really high above her head. Correct.
She had a camera up, yes, sir.
Okay. I want to show you
what's defendant's exhibit number 7. Well, I'm not going to show it to you. I'm going to move to admit defendant's exhibit number 7.
No objection.
Entered without objection.
Defendant's exhibit number 7 shows the candidate, a candidate speaking. Who is that candidate?
That is Mr. Richard Woods, who is the Georgia State School Superintendent.
And we saw him on the video, correct?
Yes, sir.
Right. And we can see right here, there's a lot of glare. The camera being held up, correct?
Yes, sir.
There. Is that better?
Yes, sir. I can see it.
Is that better? Clear wise? Exhibits. Move to admit exhibits 89.
No objection.
And now there are two other photographs of.
She's charged. We're going to take a break.
Sure. That is defendant's exhibit number 8. Already admitted. That shows Ms. Tisdale recording, and that is Mr. Woods, correct?
Definitely, sir. That's actually Mr. Butler.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Butler.
But yes, that's your video.
Yeah. And it shows the position that her camera was in when she was filming, correct? As far as you know.
Yeah, but yes, sir, largely.
Okay. Same thing with defendant's number 9. And defendant's number 9 also shows the position of the camera. Sorry, then I move to admit number 9.
No objection.
Maybe without objection.
Yes, sir, that's what it appears to show.
Well, I think it's showing her videotaping through the progression of the candidates as they come through in the position of her camera, correct?
Yes, sir, I think that's correct.
All right. Now, We saw Ms. Tisdale videotaping when you were speaking, when you were doing the introductions. I understood you to tell us that you didn't see her.
I don't recall. I mean, obviously she was there, clearly front and center, but I don't really recall. You know, making it wasn't clear to me that she didn't stand out to me.
Well, she's fairly close to you, right?
She is.
I mean, we're talking at 5 feet, 7 feet?
She was very close. At that time when I was speaking, you still had a lot of people that were moving around because people weren't really in their seats. So I was actually trying to look out in the audience more to see exactly who was where, especially the elected officials, because folks were kind of still standing and talking. Some folks weren't having a seat. So my line of vision is probably more focused a little broader than the up close and personal of Ms. Tisdale being right there.
But sure, she was right there, like 5-7 feet away.
I don't dispute that.
Arm's length away, perhaps.
Pretty close.
Okay, all right, good. and of course, since you weren't focused on her, you didn't see her, somebody 5 feet away, and you didn't say anything to her at the time.
I didn't say anything at that time, sir.
Okay. When you, as you mentioned, the governor, now we're going to talk a little bit about phasing into where people were sitting. The governor was sitting on the right in the front row, correct?
That's correct, sir.
And I'm sorry, but I think it was not his wife. It may have been his sister that was with him.
I thought Mrs. Bill was there that day with him.
Okay. But they were seated on the front row to the right, maybe 10 feet away. Is that right?
That's probably correct.
Okay. And there were a number of other candidates that were two. If you're facing the audience, there was the pickup truck.
That's right.
And to the left of the pickup truck, there were a bunch of other candidates standing there ready to go on, as it were.
To either side of the truck, essentially. To the side that I kind of initially labeled myself on, there were candidates standing there primarily waiting to go on. So depending on which way you're facing, I'm not sure that's left or right.
Okay. And there was someone, either one or two rows behind Ms. Tisdale, by the name of Brian Pritchard, correct?
That's correct.
And Brian Pritchard is also a journalist, correct?
He has a website, Adventure News, that I guess has news and blog.
Okay. And he was there, correct?
Correct.
And he was audio recording the event, correct?
I learned after the fact, yes, he was.
And he was also taking pictures, correct?
Clearly, he took photos. I didn't observe him taking photos that day.
But these are photos that he took, correct?
He did take photos, yes, sir.
Well, we know this was from behind number 8, and number 9 was from behind this Tisdale, right?
Correct.
So, we know she couldn't have been taking pictures from behind it herself.
She's not doing that, yes, sir.
What you just displayed, what is that?
That's, thank you, Judge. Defense Exhibit number 8.
Are you tendering it?
No, it's already been tendered.
No, it hasn't.
Yeah, no, I'm sorry. I thought I had tendered 8 and 9, but I'll tender 8. I
heard 9.
No objection.
And if you have objection, go ahead. Somebody else right behind Ms. Tisdale who was recording, audio recording it, and taking pictures, but we said a word to him, right?
If he did, it was with a phone, but nobody that I'm aware did.
Well, in order to get pictures like that, you got to hold it up.
I presume.
All right. Well, at any event, there was, in fact, someone else recording both audio and taking pictures at the event, right?
I know that after the fact. I didn't know that at the time.
Well, after that, after someone came to you and talked to you, was there any announcement any day from now on, you know, we're going to shut down the recording?
No, sir.
Nobody made any announcement between speakers, correct?
Yes, sir.
And nobody made any announcement after Mr. Wooten took this Tisdale away, right?
Yes, sir.
And nobody said, if there's anybody else in the audience, stop it, right?
Not that I'm aware.
So the only person, that was prohibited from taping is Ms. Tisdale, who you had no idea who she was.
right?
Ms. Tisdale is the only, I mean, she's requested to stop other than the video tracker before the event.
The only other person, right?
Those are the only two people that I think anyone was aware was recording.
So, Governor Dio was there. He doesn't say anything, correct?
Not that I'm aware.
His wife is there. She doesn't say anything.
Not that I'm aware.
Mr. Pritchard doesn't say anything.
Not that I'm aware.
Okay. Ms. Humberger, you said, was over on the right-hand side facing the speakers. Could she have been on the left?
She may have been. I thought that she was on the right-hand side facing the speakers, but it's possible she was on the left.
And did you know that as soon as she left, you mentioned her leaving, and we saw her leaving, that she called the sheriff?
I didn't object. How would you know that if she only called the sheriff?
I said, did you know? You can say no.
I learned that after the fact.
Okay.
Thank you, Judge.
Now, I understand getting to the offense itself that you were not the first person to go over to Ms. Tisdale, correct?
Correct.
There was some other person who went over there.
Mr. Burgess.
Mr. Burgess. But you were not there to hear what he said.
Correct.
You were not there to determine what was said, if anything, to Ms. Tisdale, correct?
I was not present there. I heard Ms. Tisdale's account after the fact. So.
You weren't there?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, of your own knowledge, you don't know what was said originally?
Other than what she's described in her own blogs.
And then, after that, she's still there filming, correct?
Correct.
We know that. We know that she continues to do that until she's removed. The second half of that is you go over there, correct?
I go and sit down next to Mr. Burgess.
Okay. And there's a discussion with Mr. Burgess, correct?
Correct.
And after that discussion with Mr. Burgess, do you go and talk with, who do you go talk with?
I go and talk to Officer Wooten, and then Officer Wooten and I go and talk to Johnny and Captain Burke.
Okay. And after that, you then go to the behind Ms. Tisdale, correct?
First I speak to Mr. Perdue and his wife, and then I went to speak to Officer Wooten to tell him that I would go speak to Ms. Tisdale before he had to, and then I went to speak to Ms. Tisdale. That's correct.
So we get to the point where it's you that's sitting behind Ms. Tisdale.
Right, right.
Anybody else? Not anybody else talking to
you? Yes, sir. That's right.
And when you go up, you sit behind her, correct?
I'm leaning over her left shoulder.
Okay. And addressing her.
Correct.
Correct. She has got both hands on her camera, as we saw in the picture. She's facing forward. Correct?
Correct.
One, you did not identify yourself, correct?
I didn't say my name. I don't recall saying my name.
Okay. Two, she was not at that particular point anybody. She hadn't moved, correct?
She's filming.
She's filming. She's quiet. She's so unobtrusive that you didn't see her, right?
I wasn't looking for her until the attention was called to her.
So she is so unobtrusive that nobody noticed until one of the candidates did, right?
I didn't say that no one noticed, but I didn't necessarily notice her.
Okay. And nobody had said anything to her at that point, correct?
Not that I'm aware of, Mr. Burgess prior to me.
We don't know what he said. You get up there, you sit behind her, she's filming, she's been quiet. and very clearly unobtrusive. That's what's happening at this point. You go up, sit behind her and address her, right? You tell her, not who you are, but to stop filming. Is that right?
Along the lines of that I was a representative of the birds and that they were asking her to stop filming, to stop videoing.
Okay, to stop filming, okay? And you said stop filming a number of times.
Three or four times that I made basically the same request to say, I've spoken with the birds, they're requesting that you no longer film. You can say no longer, but you don't need to film.
Okay, now wait a minute, there's a difference there. You added a tagline. What you have said previously and said to the investigators in this case was that you told them to stop filming, stop recording. Can I refresh your recollection with regard to that?
Please do. Three years and 3 months ago.
Sure. Do you recall on August 27th of 2014, you had an interview with investigator Director Edwards?
I do recall that, yes, sir.
And you told Greg Edwards that you went up and told Miss Tisdale to, and I stop recording.
Is that in my statement that I made at that time? I mean, obviously I did tell her to stop recording, yes sir, I don't dispute that.
You're a lawyer, right? You're a smart man. You are someone who lives by your words.
Correct.
And words are important.
Yes, sir.
And words are important when you're addressing someone.
Correct. Yes, sir.
And you, of all people, know the difference between stop recording, or leave, and or stop recording and leave, right?
Yes, sir.
When you were given that interview, when you were giving that interview, you had the opportunity at the time, back in August of 2014, to use the words that you thought were appropriate and that you believed to have occurred, correct?
It's a very brief interview that I gave to Mr. Edwards. It's not an extended period of time.
It was 84 pages.
My interview?
Yes, your interview was 84 pages.
Stop recording.
So, at least one time, you said, please stop recording.
Yes, sir.
Okay. The very next page, and if you want me to show you these, I'd be glad to.
You don't have a copy by chance, do you?
Sorry, I don't. Okay. But can I address Mr. Bearden up there? I know they use that equipment without asking. I'm going to go to the very next page.
Yes, sir.
That's two times.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Okay.
Three times. So at least five times, when you are asked about the content of the conversation, it was, please stop recording.
Correct.
Would that be fair?
That, I think that's fair from what I said at that time, yes, sir.
Okay. And that was August 27th of 2014, right after the event occurred, correct?
That's correct.
Tisdale did not stop recording.
You're correct, she did not.
Okay. But she didn't turn around.
Correct.
She didn't see who you were. She didn't look at you.
She did not look at me, no, sir.
You didn't identify yourself.
I did, again, as a representative of the firms.
You didn't identify yourself as a particular person.
No, sir.
And she never actually saw you, correct?
I don't think she would have, no, sir.
All right. And you were sitting behind her?
Over her left-hand side, yes, sir.
And, you know, at that particular time, you sat back. Sat back in your seat. You didn't really go anywhere else.
No, sir.
You started, you were going, okay, well, I asked. And you then started listening to the speakers.
That's right, Mark Butler was speaking.
And then Mr. Wooten came over from the left-hand side. Am I correct about that?
If you're facing the speaker, it would have been from the left-hand side. Yes, sir.
If you're facing the speaker, and that's the angle that we have seen on the videotape, and that's why I'm taking that angle.
Yes, sir.
So he comes from the left-hand side.
Correct.
Correct. He comes from the left-hand side, and we surely don't see him in the photograph. But and on the videotape, we can't hear what he says, correct?
Correct.
And you don't hear what he says.
I did not hear what he said.
Okay. So it's not on audio tape. It's not on the videotape, and you didn't hear anything either.
Yes, sir.
Now, you also indicated that, you know, I think that she was swiping in some manner.
When his hand is in front of the camera, her other hand came off and it went in the air on a swipe. Kind of like a swatting motion, basically.
You know, it could be, and you speculated that it could have been just a reaction to being grabbed and picked up, and you just gonna try to maintain your balance, aren't you?
I mean, I think you would, yes, sir. I thought that occurred before the actual physical picking up or them standing together, but I really can't say for certain.
Well, right. So, you did not see Ms. Tisdale get up of her own volition. You saw Mr. Wooten pick her up and her flailing, correct?
No, sir, I don't recall how they became standing, quite honestly.
Right, so you can't even speak to that aspect?
I mean, I saw it happen. It happened so quickly. I would just be speculating to guess how it occurred.
But you saw no physical contact then?
I thought that I saw her hand touch his face, yes, sir.
Really?
I thought that her hand made contact, but that's what I thought at the time.
But when you were here last time, you didn't say that, correct?
I did. I thought she swung it in the air.
In the air?
Yes, sir.
There's a difference between in the air and otherwise, isn't there?
I thought it may not have.
One moment, please, Jeff.
Yes, sir.
Did you say A1?
D1, defense one. Delta one, Judge, I'm sorry, Delta one. Did you see this Facebook announcement prior to the rally?
I don't recall that I did. I don't recall, but I saw it after the fact, certainly, on the advertisements and articles that have been posted.
All right. Now, did you authorize anyone or coordinate anyone to put this post out there?
No, sir.
Yes. Now, I know you testified this is, I think, 11 months after.
All right.
At the rally itself, this is 47.5 minutes, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Did you meet with or happen to see anyone from Facebook that was tallying the actual number of people that went?
No, certainly not.
Now, did you discuss with the Burks the fact that this had been advertised on Facebook prior to the rally?
Not before the rally, no, sir.
Finish three. In cross-examination, Mr. Harvey mentioned that to you, I believe, it's good for politicians. They want as many people as they can come into these things, right?
I mean, at times they do.
What about the property?
I think the property owner in this case, I mean, obviously, I can't speak for Mr. Bird, but I think he agreed to have Mr. Governor Deal at the event. That's what I discussed with him beforehand.
Just Governor Deal.
Governor Deal. I may have mentioned to him that I thought that Senator Perdue or Senate Candidate Perdue was coming beforehand, but not an expectation that it was the entire Republican ticket of people.
Back to D3, which we established, at least you did review this, that all were welcome and invited to attend. It doesn't contain any prohibitions, like y'all discussed, on filming or recording.
That's right.
Did you see any prohibitions on clothing at appropriate time?
Yes, sir.
About the use of alcohol?
Yes, sir.
Tobacco?
Yes, sir.
Nudity?
Yes, sir.
Language?
Yes, sir.
In your experience, when you're advertising for these things, are prohibitions frequently put in the ads that are on?
Not in my experience.
Now, looking back on at you recall, there was a sign in the barn prohibiting anything, just general.
At Burt's Farm?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, there is a sign in the barn that prohibits a number of things.
All right, do you remember what it prohibits?
From working there, no alcohol, no cussing, or maybe no sitting on, staying on, jumping on the pumpkins, those type of things. I think there's a prohibition about alcohol, and maybe a couple other things.
No pets?
No pets.
Now, in cross-examination, there was a discussion about, Mr. Pritchard apparently was recorded. When Ms. Tisdale is being, escorted out of the shed, the governor, I think you testified, Mr. Hart, the governor didn't say anything about the filming. Ms. Tisdale didn't say anything. Did anyone say anything about anything when she was being escorted?
When she was being escorted down, no, sir.
Did anyone get up and say, wait a minute, anything like that?
No.
Did the rally continue?
It did.
Did you see what the speaker, did he keep speaking?
He kept speaking, yes.
The document that Mr. Harper just showed me, I think he said, was that a transcription of your recorded interview?
It appears that it's a transcription of an interview.
And was it single-spaced, double-spaced?
It's double-spaced.
Was it certain font size?
It's large font size.
Certain margins?
Certain margins.
Did it appear to be prepared by a transcriber?
It does appear to be prepared by a transcriber.
How many minutes was your interview investigated?
I don't recall it being very lengthy. I mean, obviously, there's transcription, but I don't recall the interview being very long.
There's something that, if you listen to the interview, you can tell how long it was?
Oh, I could.
Now, what were the number of times you said, or at least told investigator Edwards, stop recording. Did you offer to take her to the property owners and discuss that?
I don't recall. I think we did. I did say that if she would stop recording that we could discuss the matter. Can we discuss this? Something to that effect is what I recall saying.
You recall warning her if she didn't stop recording, what would happen?
I don't recall that I warned her about anything would happen if she didn't stop recording.
Did you ever ask her to leave the property?
I didn't ask her to leave the property, no, sir.
Okay. Now, in the video when you were on the directory, you recall the scene when you and you identified the person as to have come and walk by.
Correct.
Directly from the camera at that angle.
In front of her camera, yes, sir. Yeah, we're directly in front of the camera at that point, yes.
So the duration of time from when you walked directly in front of that camera to when you spoke?
A few minutes. I mean, a couple of minutes passed by because when I came back and Officer Rudin's behind me and was showing that video, I observed Mr. Burgess was seated next to Ms. Tisdale. I sit down next to Mr. Burgess, had a conversation, then I went with Officer Wooten to speak to the birds. Then I spoke very briefly to Mr. Purdue, and then came back over. So there are a few minutes that passed. There's 2 or 3 minutes, I think, in that time period.
Did you disguise or alter your voice at all when you were speaking?
No, sir.
Thank you.
Maybe I was confused. You were asked about authorizations and talking to folks about authorizations. You were not an authorized representative of
Yes, sir.
You were not there as an authorized representative of the Republican Party, correct?
Yes, sir.
You had no authority one way or the other to set the terms and conditions of the event itself, correct?
Only what Mr. Bearden would convey to that limit.
That's fine, but I'm talking about setting up the event, advertising the event, promoting the event. That was not Clint Bearden's responsibility.
I did not do that, no, sir.
And in fact, it was the Republican Party or representatives of the Republican Party that first broached the subject of the filming, correct?
You're correct, yes, sir.
Okay. And indeed, at the beginning, neither you or Johnny Burke had any objection to filming. In fact, that's what you told Investigator Edwards, correct?
I think that's correct, yes, sir.
Okay. And anything that had to do with, boy, I don't know whether we're going to or should allow the filming, came from the Republican Party, which you had no authority over, right?
They made a request of me to talk to Mr. Burke.
They?
The Republican Party.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Want to excuse this witness?
He unfortunately cannot be excused and remains under subpoena, but I would like to put him on call. That's all right.
Thank you.
You know what that means, Mr. Beard.
Yes, Your Honor. Thank you.